Hi everyone, I'm Aki, and actually that's a great intro because the alternate title for this was something like, look at this one weird trick that makes GHC totally hang, like, or GHCs hate him or something. My name's Aki, I was at Hacker School last summer. I work for Rent the Runway right now on warehouse and fulfillment software. I'm not gonna talk about that. I'm gonna talk about this crazy type that Hindley-Milner infers for this tiny program. I'm gonna require a little bit of background, but I'm gonna try and give you a crash course in the lambda calculus as quickly as possible. If you have some familiarity with Hindley-Milner languages, OCaml, Haskell, standard ML, you can kind of, you'll be able to follow along, but for everyone else, we're just gonna run through some of the syntax I'll be using. So this is the grammar for the lambda calculus. If you know one of those ML-like languages, you will be able to, this sort of, you can think of this as a subset of your favorite Hindley-Milner language. If you don't know one of those languages, just consider it like a mini functional language. There's four different kinds of terms in the language. The first one is variables. The second one is functions, which are defined with this lambda symbol and take a single argument, in this case named x, and have a body containing some other expression. The period here is just syntax to separate those two. Third, we have function application, which is just the function applied to an argument, and they're just put next to each other. I'll use parentheses a little bit later for precedence. And finally, we have let, which is just a way of introducing a local variable, in this case, again, named x, binding it to an expression e, and then evaluating some body. So this programming language has no types. There's no type annotations here, and that's where Hindley-Milner comes in. It's a classic type inference algorithm that was invented slash discovered twice, once in the 60s, later in the 70s. Effectively, programmers write untyped code, the compiler deduces their types, and then checks their usages. It's used in standard ML, OCaml, F#, Haskell, and some other languages. I just want to note it specifically, it's not used in Scala. Scala has a different system. Scala C is slow for different reasons. So usually this algorithm is described as quote unquote fast enough, which I think basically means that people don't complain about GHC the way they complain about Scala C. But the truth is a little more complicated, it turns out. There are two features I want to talk about before I get to this sort of worst case scenario with Hindley-Milner. The first is something called let polymorphism. So Hindley-Milner supports parametric polymorphism, which is the same thing as generics in C# and Java. This is the polymorphic identity function, which takes a type, a value of a type A, and returns the same value unchanging it. So the type of this function is A to A. Here's the sort of familiar map. Our lambda calculus doesn't have lists, but you have lists in Haskell and so on. So this is just another example of a parametrically polymorphic value. Okay, so let's get back to let. There's basically two ways of introducing local variables in our little lambda calculus. The first one is let, and the second one is lambda. In let, we call a variable bound in a let, in this case, this x, as a let. We call it a let bound variable, and in the lambda, we call it a lambda bound variable. If you're coming from Lisp, which is where I was before I came to ML, there's this relationship between let and lambda that is kind of familiar. You usually see this as like the first macro you might learn, because you can implement let as a macro in terms of lambda and function application. So here's a let. The sort of tilde arrow thing is just sort of suggesting that we can transform this into a lambda that's being applied to the expression. Both of these were introducing a local variable named x, binding it to some e, and then evaluating the body. JavaScript programmers, I think, call this immediately invoked function expressions, and it's sort of to do with the way JavaScript does scoping. It turns out there's a really crucial difference with the way let-bound variables and lambda-bound variables are typed in Hindley-Milner languages. Here's another example of a little program using let. We're introducing this polymorphic identity function, binding it to ID, and then calling it with 3 and true. And I'm sort of cheating here using a tuple and these literals, but you can imagine in a real language we'd have these. This program type checks under Hindley-Milner without any problem. Here's the same example if we transformed it using a macro. We're applying a function to an anonymous identity, binding it to ID, and applying it to 3 and true. It turns out that this doesn't type check under Hindley-Milner, and this is this sort of weird thing where lambda-bound variables are not allowed to have polymorphic values, but let-bound variables are. This is the type error we get when we punch it into the standard ML REPL. So it turns out that let is this important feature of the languages. It's not just syntactic sugar, and it's called let polymorphism. The way we type check this in a naive way is to literally copy and paste the code. So the compiler will generate an int version and a Boolean version of the identity and apply them in the right place in the body. There's other ways to implement this that are not naive and like kind of stupid, but this is, I think, conceptually easy to understand. So the second thing I want to talk about is exponential function composition. This is just sort of something that falls out from just the way let works. Effectively, let allows us to concisely express exponential function composition. Here's another little program that uses let. X naught is just bound to the familiar identity function we had earlier. X1 is a function that takes an argument and just applies X naught to that argument and then applies X naught again. This really isn't that interesting. X1 is just the identity again, but sort of getting somewhere in a little bit. Here's another program. It's the same, but has another level of nesting. So X2 is just calling X1 twice with some argument Y. You can probably see where this is going. At each step of nesting, we're doubling the number of times we compose X0. So once we do another level of nesting, X3 is going to compose X0 eight times. So let allows us to succinctly express function composition. And now we're ready for this pathological case. So it turns out that Hindley-Milner, in the worst case, takes an exponential amount of time in the size of the source program to type check, to infer types for that program. There's these two features, the let polymorphism and exponential composition, that conspire together to degrade the performance this badly. Without let, you can do type inference in linear time. And so it's kind of interesting to me that there's this feature that it doesn't just change it by an order of magnitude or something, it's like really, really bad. So here's another program similar to the last one, but we've changed X0. X0 is now the pair function from the lambda calculus. The details are not that important, but essentially this is how to simulate a pair constructor when all you have is functions. The rest of the program is the same. We're just composing X0 an exponential number of times. You can see this is basically the same, we've just changed the initial version of X0. I've translated this to standard ML so that I can put it in the REPL, and I've also gotten rid of the actual let, because the way that standard ML and all these ML-derived languages do top-level bindings is very similar to let, and the values can be polymorphic. And what this allows us to do is actually inspect the types of each of these X's as we enter them into the REPL. So X0's type is not that bad. It's like got two type variables, and it's a function that takes a value, it takes another function, and returns another value. X1 is like tricky, but I've written some small, medium-sized programs, ML programs, and used some generic libraries that use types this large. And it's, you know, maybe you have to pick it apart, you have to read the docs. In the worst case, maybe you have to like read the paper that the library is based on, but you can imagine figuring this out. X2 is starting to get a little intimidating, and it's starting to look like maybe something is going wrong, but at least the type fits on one slide. This is the type of X3, and it is completely absurd. Remember that this is just an 8 times function composition of the lambda calculus pair. And this is just the first page of the type. This is the second page, this is the third page, and finally, this is the last page. So you can imagine what X4 would look like. And it turns out that when I experimented with this in standard ML, OCaml, and Haskell, the MLs, for some reason, kind of can't handle a nesting deeper than 3 or 4. With standard ML, type checking X4 took over 8 hours on my MacBook Pro. And I know that, you know, it's kind of a toy computer, but it's usually not, builds don't take that long. GHC gets up to around 9 or 10 before it just kind of hangs. So this is really interesting. I actually don't really still understand why this happens, but it's the combination of polymorphic let and the exponential function composition that sort of conspire in this way. And there's just a lot more for me to dig into. I just want to talk about one of the references. So I learned about this on Stack Overflow. There's this great question and answer about that sort of demos this thing. But this paper is what I really want to just touch on briefly in my last minute, because so this is from 1990. There were a couple of different people who sort of hit upon this idea and figured out that like how to prove that ML typing was exponential in the worst case. But this has this other feature that's really, really interesting, is that the way they prove this, in the paper, one of the author's colleagues suggests that they title the paper something different, which is how to compile Turing machines to ML types. It's mind-bogglingly weird proof technique where they effectively take a Turing machine embed it inside ML's type system and use the type inference algorithm, which is using unification in the background, if you're familiar with Prolog and pattern matching. And they use unification to drive the Turing machine to go through its steps. And this is something, I feel like there's like a whole like bunch of other talks that I should be looking into writing for this. But anyway, if you want to talk more about this, please see me and maybe download this paper and read it so that you can help me figure it out. Thanks.